Hello, my lovely teacher friends. How is it going? How are you? I know you're heading towards your pedagogy exam in the first week of April, and many of you are requesting me on my channel in the comment section, as well as sending me the emails on my channel's email ID to upload a lot of videos about some unique topics. So today I decided to tell you about a very unique topic that we got a question on, and we never thought this will be a part of our questioning session during the TLS pedagogy exam. Yes, I'm talking about team building and the stages of team building. So in this video, I'm going to tell you what team building is, what are the five stages of team building, and in the end, I have a surprise for you. Yes, I'm going to share the question that we got in October 2019's TLS pedagogy exam, so that you have an idea what sort of question can be given to you as well. Sometimes questions are given repeatedly, so you have a chance that you can get the same question too. So stick around with me till the end of the video. I'll be explaining you what team building is. We'll be going through all the stages one by one categorically, and we'll see what are the attributes of each stage, because we got questions related to the stages of team building. And at the end, definitely I'll share the question. I'm sure after so much of explanation, you'll be able to make out the right answer. Drop your answer in the comment section below and I'll instantly answer you whether it's right or not. Till then, let's get started and stick around with me till the end of the video. So as I told you in the intro that we got a question on this topic, and if you're a first timer, you're preparing for your TLS pedagogy exam for the first time, you might not be having an idea that you can even get a question on this topic. So that's why I thought it might be very important for you to know about it. So our topic for today is team building. We got a question on this. It's related to team development, and it's also related to the stages in team building. So let's not wait any further and see what I have in store. But before we proceed, just a humble request, subscribe to my channel. There are very informative videos about TLS pedagogy. Not only that, in future you have to appear for your IELTS exam for language proficiency test. So I have some very informative and lucrative videos about IELTS speaking, reading and writing. Not only that, it can also improve your communication skills to be used in your real life for communication. So hit the subscribe button and become a permanent subscriber. So let's see what our topic is all about. It's about team building. We got a question about this topic. You might not even have thought about it that you can get a question about it, but let me explain you that what is team building all about. So research has shown that teams go through definitive stages during development. So this is about the five stages of team building. So Bruce Tuckman, an educational psychologist, identified a five-stage development process that most teams follow to become high performing. So we got a question based on those stages. So let's review what are the stages. The first stage is called forming. It leads to the second stage. These are sequential stages. So second stage is called storming, which leads further to norming. That is stage number three, which leads to performing. That is stage number four. And then it leads to the last stage, which is adjourning. So that is stage number five. So you can make an acronym or a mnemonic to learn these stages. You can make F for the first one, S for the second one, N for the third stage, P for the fourth stage, and A for the last stage. So you have a mnemonic, that is FSNPA. So remember this mnemonic: F for forming, S for storming, N for norming, P for performing, and A for adjourning. So remember this mnemonic in your mind: FSNPA. These are the five stages of team building. So let's review the stages of team building in detail. The first stage is called forming. So imagine what happens in this stage. Team acquaints and establishes ground rules, and formalities are preserved and members are treated as strangers. So I'll give you a scenario. For example, this is the first day of your class. So what happens? There are new students in your class. Let's say you have a class of 30 students and all students are new. So what will happen on the first day? You're just forming their groups. So each class member will get to know each other, will get to acquaint himself or herself with other class members and the group members, and you're obviously going to set some ground rules that, okay, you don't have to leave the class, you can only leave it in the break time, you have to come in the proper uniform. So you're discussing all the formalities, and you're just still all the members are treated as strangers because it's their first day. You made groups in class,
but they don't know each other in detail. They don't know their likes and dislikes. So this is the first day of their class. So this stage perhaps can be linked with this example of forming. This stage leads to another stage, which is called storming. What happens in that stage? Members start to communicate their feelings, but still view themselves as individuals rather than part of the team. Imagine you've just met a group of people on the very first day in your class. But what happens? You don't get along so quickly. Obviously, you need time to know your differences of opinion. You need to have some time to settle down with each other as a team. So it doesn't happen in one day. Obviously, it needs time. As they say, Rome was not built in a day. Similarly, a team is not built in a day or so. It needs time to get to know each other. So in this stage of storming, imagine this is the first week of your class and all the students are new. You make a group, there's a class of 30 students and you've divided them into a group of 10 students each. So there are three groups. So what happens? In each group, there are 10 students. So they got to know each other in the stage of forming. They know, okay, her name is Jane, so-and-so's name is whatever. So they'll get to know their names, the class rules. In the second, let's say it's the second week of your session of the year, so they still don't know. In the first week they acquainted themselves. In the second week, all the group members might be going through this stage, which is called storming. So what happens? Members start to communicate their feelings. They'll be getting to know each other, that okay, you belong to Egypt, okay, you are from Sudan, okay, you are from Philippines, all right, you are from Pakistan, you're from India. People will be knowing each other, and then they'll get to know, okay, a Pakistani student might feel good with another Asian student, or a Filipino student might feel comfortable with Filipino students only because they have some language barrier. Similarly, an Arab student might feel comfortable with an Arab student. But what happens? You just see yourselves as different people because you haven't yet settled down your differences of culture and opinion. But after a while, you do settle very well. You do pick up each other's language. For example, I'm a Pakistani, but I know a few Arabic phrases because with passage of time, I picked the language from my students, from my Arab teachers. Similarly, they know our language, they know our native language, they pick from us. So this happens at a later stage. In storming, you still see yourselves as individuals because you haven't had the time to settle down the differences and to get to know each other in detail. In the next stage, which is very important for growth, that is the growth of a team, which is called norming. People feel part of the team and realize that they can achieve work if they accept others' viewpoints. So you start supporting each other. Look at this picture. You start supporting each other. You establish different norms. Let's say it's the fourth week of your new class. You're in charge of grade 10 and your class has moved successfully from week 1, week 2 to week 3. Now you see there will be acceptance between each other and all the group members will get along nicely. They'll become friends because they know they are a part of the team and they realize that they can achieve work if they accept others' viewpoint. Let me give you another example. Let's say I'm an English teacher. Obviously, I'll give you an example from my subject. Let's say you have decided that there is a group of 30 students. So you divided them into a group of 10 students and you said you're going to have a competition for a role play. All the students will be working to play in a drama called Hamlet, and the first group will be winning the trophy, second group will be given snack box from KFC, and the third group will be given one free period. So there are different prizes. Obviously, all will work to win the trophy. So what will happen? Once you have made the group, you've told them, let's say you picked one member from each group to make a new group. So what will happen? The first stage is forming. They'll get to know each other because all the students you've chosen belong to different groups in your class. Then they will decide the roles that, okay, I'll be Hamlet, you be Ophelia, you design the dresses, you have arranged the sound effects, the background music. So they might, one student might say, no, I want to be Hamlet. Why do you want to be Hamlet? I want to be the lead character. Another person might say, I don't want to be Ophelia, you be Ophelia, I want to take a male character. Another student might say, I don't like arranging for costumes, I want to arrange for the background music. So there might be storming. Later on, once they have settled down these differences, they'll say, okay, fine, we guess this person is best for Hamlet because we checked through audition. This person might be best for background music because he loves, his passion is music. So you've reached the stage where you are in the stage of norming, you're accepting after discussion, after storming, you're accepting each other's differences. Next, so you have decided, okay, you can be Hamlet, fine, because you work very good as a lead character, your voice has that impact that we want to bring in the play. You be the music, background music provider, because you have an interest in music, you know what to, which music is best for the background. So you are in the stage of norming, because you're supporting each other as per your aptitude, because you know you're all working towards that one trophy, the first position that you want to win. That's why you have adapted yourselves to a stage of norming. This stage obviously leads to another stage, which is performing. Remember, all these stages are sequential. So once you have accepted each other's differences, the team works on in an open and trusting atmosphere where flexibility is the key and the hierarchy of title is not of any importance. You don't, for example, in a team, you've decided that, okay, person A deserves to be the lead character because his voice has that impact. He's very expressive. So right now you're working towards the goal of the trophy. So hierarchy is not a problem. It's all right if someone is doing the lead role because someone deserves the lead role. So your focus is on performing. Your focus is not on getting the position that you want. Your focus is on getting the goal, achieving the goal. So you settle down the differences and all of you work towards performance because your goal is one, that is the main achieving your target. And this stage finally leads to adjourning. The team conducts an assessment of the year and implements a plan for transitioning roles and recognizing members' contributions. Let's say they perform the play Hamlet and they won the first position, the so-and-so group A. So what will happen? They say, okay, this person we chose as Hamlet was really he really deserved to be the lead character, that's why we won the first position. Let him be the lead character in the next role play we have. So you're reviewing your performance, you're assessing your performance and your transitioning role. For example, in the second example, if you say, we saw that the person who arranged the costumes was not as good as the second person who suggested the last moment changes and they seem to be perfect. So he told us to add the badge for Hamlet, he told us to arrange this for Hamlet, this for Ophelia. So we believe that if both of them are coupled together as a group or as a pair, they might end up as a recipe for success. So next time this person plus this person will be the costume designers because the last moment changes suggested by person B were also very good. So you are assessing and you are changing rules, you are transitioning roles here. And you are recognizing that this member's contribution was more effective than we expected, so he deserves a better role so that our team at the end achieves a better goal. So this is what these stages are all about, because at the end you all win. So you can tag these pictures in mind so that it's not a problem for you at all. So let's see the stages and the characteristics. The first stage is called forming. And what are the characteristics of the stage? A team meets, it's called the formation stage. You begin collective work. So what's the role of the team leader here? You outline your mission. A team leader looks for arrangement, for agreement on team roles, rules, guidelines for decision making. For example, when your class comes on the first day, you make a class prefect, you tell the rules, you say, okay, you can only go during the break time, don't go out during the regular class time. So you provide them guidelines, you set up rules and you make decisions. So that's all about forming. Second stage is called storming. A team deals with confusion and conflict over goals, decision making roles and control. Let's say you have given a role play to your class that you have to perform Hamlet, the play Hamlet. So your team is going to say, student A will say, I want to be Ophelia. Student B will say, no, I want to be Ophelia. So there is a confusion that who can be a better Ophelia. Similarly, one person will say, I want to direct the play. Person C is saying, I want to direct the play. Person D is saying, I want to direct the play. So a team deals with confusion and conflict over goals, decision-making roles, and control because they haven't settled down the differences in the stage of storming. So you facilitate discussion, you ensure common understanding of agreements. So what happens? You can say, okay, A also wants to be Ophelia, B also wants to be Ophelia. We can have an audition. So whoever performs better, we'll have a poll, we'll have votes. So all the class votes for A to be Ophelia. So you facilitated the decision with the help of facilitated discussion. You ensured a common understanding of agreement by taking votes, and you said, okay, person A deserves to be Ophelia because she did really well. Next stage is called norming. A team accepts goals, roles, rules, works positively. So once you have decided that in a role play that you've given to a particular group, okay, this person is the director, and the whole team accepts that, okay, yes, he deserves to be the better director. This person is Hamlet. Okay, this person is... So every day we are going to work 1 hour rehearsal, and we are... So this is what you're setting up the rules, and all of you work positively. So a team leader encourages norming process, supports and coaches, and celebrates success finally. So what happens once your team has established and reached the stage of norming? Obviously, a team leader will know that, okay, this person is doing this, this person is doing this. So you support and coach each other, you guide each other. For example, a group of students is doing the play Hamlet, and you've reached the stage of norming, so you're going to say, oh, Hamlet, I think while doing this role, this dress, this costume will be perfect. You show some samples. So you're supporting and coaching and mentoring your group members. And once you've decided that, okay, this music is the best, all of the group members say, this music suits the best for this scene to be or not to be, that is the question. So what will happen? You celebrate success. You all have agreed upon one idea. You coach each other. You mentor each other. And you celebrate success. And the last stage, performing. A team focuses on achieving goals. Once you've reached this stage, you focus on achieving your goals, your personal growth for team members. Conflicts are handled positively. For example, if I'll give you same example that your class is doing a role play on Hamlet. So there is growth for team members and conflicts are handled positively. For example, you say that this costume does not suit for Ophelia as much as this might suit person B's costume. So a person B who is suggesting that costume should be changed for Ophelia, and all the group members have a look at the picture and say, yes, this person seems to be right. So you all perform well towards one goal. So you handle the conflict positively. You say, yes, yes, we'll buy this dress instead of the one we chose before. So your basic goal is to encourage high performance. You facilitate communication to have your goal being achieved, and you celebrate success. And now we've come to a very important part of this video, because we got this question in our TLS pedagogy exam in October. Let's look at the question. Team building process goes through 4 stages, although there are 5 stages, but we got a question based on 4 stages. Based on the chart below, which shows the relationship between the team performance and time it takes to perform the task, in which stage does the team begin to work in harmony? Trust me, you don't even need to look at the chart. You already know. If you have the in-depth knowledge of the 4 stages, then the answer is very clear. You don't need to look at the chart, because I told you, remember the example of a role play. Let's say you are a part of the group. You are 10 teachers, and on the annual teacher's day, you have to perform a play. So you are a group of 10 teachers. So what is the first stage? Maybe your principal or the headmistress formed a group for you. So first stage is forming. Let's say all English teachers are performing, and or let's say all different teachers from different departments are made into a group. So you are mostly familiar with your department, but not with the other departments. So first stage is forming. You have a science teacher, you have a maths teacher, you have a physics teacher in your group. So in this stage of forming, you will just get to know each other that, okay, this is the science teacher, this is a maths teacher, and we are working as a group. The next stage is storming, in which the English teacher will say, okay, I'm the English teacher, I deserve to be the lead character. But a bio teacher might say, I have a lot of interest, I have a very good I possess extremely good acting skills. Let me be the lead character. So the second stage is storming. You are not in harmony. You are fighting for the lead role, or you want to have the best role. So maybe your group of teacher decides that, okay, let's take the audition. And you get to know that person B was right. Person B is not an English teacher, but acts very well as the lead character. So let person B be the main character. Even person A starts agreeing upon that through audition. So after the storming, you are in a stage of harmony where after experimenting, you've reached a conclusion. You all agree upon one decision that all right, person B deserves to be the main character, because through auditioning, we checked that he is the better Hamlet than person A. So let this person take the lead role. So you've reached a stage of harmony where all of you are harmoniously agreeing upon one idea that yes, our main goal is the trophy that we have to win. So let's not have differences of opinion, but work towards one goal. So this is the stage where you reach a stage of harmony. After you reach this stage, you start performing as a team and you start working towards one goal, because you don't have any more differences, but you focus more on your performance, on the quality of work as a team, because you have to win as a team. So obviously, if you know the stages, if you know the attributes of each stage, then I don't think answering this question will be a problem. You don't even need to look at this chart. You already know the answer. Write in the comment section what's your answer and I'll answer you instantly. I'm sure you are very clear-headed about it, because I've explained the stages in detail, so you are able to figure out the answer. Let me know in the comment section what your answer is. I already gave you a lot of hints, and this is my final hint. Okay, and I hope you've already acquainted yourselves well with all these stages. Do prepare well for this question. You might also get a question from this. So learn the attributes of each stage. Learn the mnemonic that I told you. The first stage is called forming, second stage is storming, third stage is norming, fourth stage is performing, and the last stage is adjourning. So FSNPA, this is the mnemonic or the acronym which you should remember. So that was all from my side. I tried to help you by providing you about a unique information about a unique topic that we got questions on. Please subscribe to my channel, share it in your circle of friends, and if you want to improve your communication skills, trust me, try some of my videos about IELTS speaking, where I have taught through acting, and there are many comments at the bottom of the video which my students have left, and trust me, there is a tremendous increase in their vocabulary, in their written expression. It's also going to help you. So best of luck for your pedagogy exam. I'll see you in my next video. Best of luck. Take care.